Hello YouTubers, and welcome to part two of how a trip breaker or a circuit breaker works. Now in part two, we're going to have a look at the instantaneous brake. I'm going to demonstrate how a solenoid acts to activate the instantaneous trip, and we're going to take measurements on an oscilloscope and see if we can get any correlation with perhaps the voltage, the current, or the energy which is applied to activate an instantaneous trip. And we're going to do that for both DC and AC. Now from part one, you'll recall that the bimetal strip was used to cater for any overload situation. But of course, if you've got an instantaneous inrush of current or a short circuit, that bimetal strip is going to take too long before it starts heating up and then activates the trip. So that's where we rely on the solenoid. Now the solenoid has this piston or plunger, which has got a spring activation. And when there's enough energy or enough current flowing through, that's going to activate and activate the trip on this side. Now, in this particular circuit breaker, this solenoid requires a lot of current, so it's very difficult to show how it works. So I've got another solenoid which is activated on far lower current. So I'm going to demonstrate that and show how, once you hit a certain current point, how it activates. It activates far quicker than the action of the bimetal strip to activate an instantaneous trip. I've got the solenoid wired up to my power supply, and I've got the metrics in line so that we can see the current that goes to it. Now for the first demonstration, I'm just going to switch the output straight on so that you can see the solenoid activate. There we go, you can see the piston or the plunger pushes through, and when the current is released, it comes back because it's got the spring which is pulling it back. So there we go, that's the activation. Now I'm going to drop the current. We saw it activated at around 470 milliamp. I'm going to switch on the output, but the output is going to be low, and I'm going to dial it up slowly. And as it reaches a certain critical point, there'll be enough energy and magnetism in the coil to activate the plunger. So let's see, it should be around 300 to 450, I think. Right. So there you go. But what I want to demonstrate, it's not like the coil that slowly starts reacting. Once it has enough current to activate, the plunger is suddenly thrown forward. And that's exactly the type of behavior that you want in an overload situation. You don't want a kind of system which is slowly going to activate. You want something which is going to jump in and activate the trip. I'll just explain the setup that I'm going to use for the instantaneous DC trip. I've got the Keysight ready to capture the pulse as it happens. I've got the DC breaker or trip switch set over here. I have my clamp which I've zeroed to measure the current. I've got the probe set over there to measure the voltage. I'm going to be noting certain measurement values. We'll do this a few times. I just want to see if there is any correlation between these measurements. Also, I know, like for instance, the time of the pulse width will become interesting once we do the AC instantaneous test. A couple of measurements I have got here is the peak-to-peak value of the current and the RMS value. And there's a good chance these measurements might disprove something I did a video on earlier, but we'll see. I'm not sure how the measurements are going to shake out, but I'll note them and we can look at them afterwards. For the first test, I'm going to simply tap the crocodile clip against the contact on the breaker to activate the trip, just to show you how it instantaneously trips and we'll capture it. That method though will perhaps create sparks, which is not a great idea. Also, it creates a very noisy signal for capturing. It'll be far better, what I'm going to do is actually connect the clip and then activate the trip by merely throwing the trip switch. It means I can get far more consistent and cleaner results on the scope. But for the first one, I'll put the breaker on and I'll throw it now. There's about 50 amp at about, it's set for 9 volt, but of course I made the mistake in the first video, that 9 volt is going to drop down to virtually zero, potentially zero, we'll see on the scope when I actually throw it. Bang, there we go. Now the noise, this actually isn't too bad. I've seen far noisier signals, but I'll bring you in closer to have a look. I'm just going to adjust the time base out and get it centered so that the full screen or full scale measurements are correct. There we go. So that's going to be the closest I can get without clipping off the signal on either edge of the screen. And okay, so we've got a DC RMS voltage value. The yellow trace is the current. You can see it is up there for a while and then that dropped off. The pink trace is a mathematical, that is the power, which is channel 1 multiplied by channel 2, and the blue is the voltage. So I'll just bring us out again quickly. We can see the behavior, where as the trip activated, you can see there's a fair bit of energy coming through initially. The current was at a constant level, and then it drops off and actually switches off as the trip is broken. And what I'm going to do is note all these measurements, in particular to look at the peak to peak and the RMS value of the current. The pulse width will also become interesting once we start looking at the AC instantaneous trips. I'm ready. What I've done, I've connected the crocodile clip. The breaker is in the off position. We'll just set up ready to capture a single. And this is far easier. You tend to get a far cleaner, more consistent capture when you do it this way. So if I do that, there we go, straight away on the screen. I'm going to note those values. I'm going to do about 3 or 4 of those, and then we'll look at the results. So I've noted all the measurements from the previous test. Now, for the previous test, I had the voltage limit. I'll say the limit. It's not obviously the voltage. The voltage drops off when there's that short. I had the voltage limit set to 9 volt. I had the current set to about 25 amp. Now you'll note that we were getting more current, and on the power supply that I've got, I've realized that the initial inrush current isn't limited by the power supply. It's not limiting quick enough. So I think potentially you have far more current available, even though the limit is set lower than the maximum. But what I have done for the next test, just to see if results will vary, I've set the voltage limit up to the top end of 20 volts, and I've turned the current limit, not that it's necessarily going to play a part, all the way up to 50. So potentially we've got far more energy available, and we'll start noting the figures on that testing. Bang. So immediately, just looking at the results, where we were sitting at around 1.9 volts previously, we're now sitting at a DC RMS value. I'm going to have to set the scale correct before I take a wrong reading. There we go. So that's just about full scale. So we've got a DC RMS now of 5.5 volts versus about 1.9 something volts that we had previously. The energy, which was sitting around 370, 330, 340 mark, is now up at 780 odd milliwatt seconds. The peak-to-peak current is sitting at 34.6. The RMS is sitting at 34.4. So I'll take a few more measurements. The one interesting thing to note is the period is down to 4.8 seconds, where it was around 9.5, 7.7, 8.5 for the previous testing. So I'll do a few more of those. So that's the last measurement I took at the higher settings. If we go through these, we can see that for the first set of results, where I had the more limit on the voltage, the voltage RMS was sitting around 1.6, 1.9 volt. The energy, so the math function, I've got a calculation on there which calculates the area, which is the energy in milliwatt seconds. So that was fairly constant, kind of in the 300s. Then we've got the peak-to-peak current around 34. The amps RMS, 28, near 29, 29, 28. And then the pulse width was around 9, 7, 7, around, averaging probably top end near 8. When we set the limit on the voltage higher, again, I upped the current limit, but I don't think that's playing a part because of the power supply, and we can probably see that in the results of the current over here. We could certainly see there was a higher voltage during that pulse. So if we combine the higher voltage with the current, there's more energy flowing into that solenoid, and I think that probably accounts for why the pulse width was shorter. So there's more energy being magnetizing the solenoid, so it was able to trigger quicker. That's my summation. I could be incorrect. So the one thing I do want to point out, which I find interesting, is that the amps peaked peak across both of these, even though there was the energy was different and the voltage levels were different, the amps peak to peak remained fairly constant, around 34 point something, all around 34. So yeah, that was the interesting takeaway there, but let's jump in and do the AC instantaneous trips. So as we get ready to do the AC test, let me just explain the setup to you. I've got a variac so that I can vary the voltage. We might play with that just to see if it has an impact on the results, but ultimately it's there for safety. It means I'm going to do the testing rather than at, let's say, 120 volts. I'm going to be doing at a low voltage just to help with the safety. I'll warn you, I wouldn't recommend you doing this at home. It can be very dangerous. I'm taking as many precautions as possible, but there's still a risk something could go awry. I've got several earth leakage devices. I've got one there and I've got one under the desk. So it should I, for instance, become a part of the circuit and draw current out of the test, hopefully those will kick in. I have tested them, they do work. So we've got that. I've got a set of light bulbs. I'm going to demonstrate why I'm using light bulbs to create a kind of instantaneous rush of current versus an AC motor, let's say. I've got far more control over the inrush and the amount of energy than I do over the AC motor with the variable speed control. So that's why I'm using the incandescent light globes. I'll show you the inrush on the scope just now. I've got the current probe. I am using a differential probe. It is a cheap one, and you can see that the signals on the scope, although you probably can't see it from where you are, they're not the cleanest. I've got this on high definition, and still there's a little bit of kinkiness, and I'm fairly sure that's because I'm using this cheap differential probe, but that at least gives me isolation from the earth. It's safer for higher voltages, and it gives me isolation from the common earthing of the oscilloscope. Then I've got two trip switches. The one is rated for 2 amp. That allows me to make settings and adjustments without the trip taking off, because the one that we're going to use is a half amp. So I've got them wired in parallel. When I make the settings, I use a 2 amp, I switch that off, and then we do the settings on the half amp. So I'll set up for that and we'll start the testing. I also have my Gossen here just set up for power readings. It's in line so I can see both the voltage and the current, and that I'm just using to actually double check and make sure that the readings I'm getting on the scope are fairly the same. And I've done that and that's correct. If I go and make changes on the variac over here, you'll see the voltage level. Was it 45? I can dial that all the way up. As I dial that up, you'll see the globes are getting higher. We're at 1.4 amp. If I exceed that 1.4 amp and go over 2 amp, then we'll be tripping the switch. So I'll bring it all back down and now we'll jump into the testing. The first thing I'll demonstrate on the scope is a nice inrush current we get when I switch on the switch and bring the light bulbs in. So I'm going to do the 2 amp breaker. I'm not trying to trip anything. I just want to demonstrate the nice inrush current that we get. So there we go. That's captured that. I'll just switch that off. And I've still got the maths function, so I'm going to switch off the maths function and the voltage. Switch that off. So now we're just left in the current. I'll bring you in for a closer look. So I'll just change the time base. But as you can see, you get a nice peak inrush, and then the current settles down to its kind of operational where it's just running the incandescent lights. But it's that inrush which is potentially going to trigger the trip switch. And it's far easier to control with the incandescent light bulbs. I can add or remove light bulbs to change the amount of energy that's coming in, and also play around with the voltage as well. But let's just see, I'm going to set it up again and we'll start looking at the measurements that we get. What I'm going to do for this first test, I've got the camera further back just so you can see everything in view before I kind of fire off and get the other results. I'm going to switch off the switch which switches on the globes on this light strip, and I then switch on the breaker. I've got set up ready for a single on the scope. I'm going to flick on these lights to get that sudden inrush which should trip the breaker. There we go, bang. It fired, it tripped, but the oscilloscope didn't capture anything, so I need to make some changes and we'll try and capture that again. There we go. So we've got our first trip. I'm going to bring you in and we'll have a look at the result. Just before I do show you the scope, I'll just give you a close-up of how quickly the instantaneous trip happens. So I'm going to switch off the light globes. I'm going to switch on or arm the triple breaker switch. So you can see it's in the on position. And then I just bang. You can see the switch goes down. I just do it once more. keep an eye on it, bang, instantly down. So that's the instantaneous trip, which is being activated by the plunger of the solenoid. So I'll take a closer look at the signal. What I aim to do for these is try and keep the time base the same. So a total of 16, just around 16 milliseconds, which would be equate to a complete period. And that means we'll have the same settings for the full screen or full scale measurements. I pulled in the time base to 1.7 milliseconds per division. That's 17 milliseconds, which if you round up is the nearest I'm going to get for a full cycle. And that's the measurements I'll work to. I've noted all of the measurements here in terms of the RMS voltage, the energy, which is 1.293 watt seconds, the peak to peak current, the RMS current, and here it's got the pulse width of the current. Now, looking at that measurement, 5.291, I think it is, I'm not sure where it's taking the measurement from. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to resort to using the cursors for the measurement just to make sure I get a consistent measurement of the actual pulse across the baseline. There we go. So having set the cursors manually, we come up with 6.33, which is what I'll note for the measurement. Now I'm just going to set up and repeat the process several times, arming the trip switch. I'll do this a few times, note the measurements, and then we'll look and see what we've got. Now this is one of the results I was intrigued to get, so I pulled you in a little bit closer. I've gone and noted all the figures. Now, once we look at all the results, we'll see that perhaps things now start to also get interesting again when we look at the peak-to-peak and RMS value of the current, but we'll come back to that later. But in terms of pulse width, the cursors are set at the previous pulse width, which was just over 6 milliseconds. And now we can see the pulse width from the start of when the actual instantaneous switch happened to where it ended is longer. So I'm just gonna draw the cursor out to the start of that. We'll look at the cursors and we've got 10.5 milliseconds. So why is that now that we've got that change? Why has it taken that much longer for the instantaneous trip to happen? And here's what I'm going to surmise. If we have a look at the period, so we'll pull in, this was the AC cycle just prior to me activating and tripping the trip switch. We'll see it's just come through a negative and it was coming up to the zero line. So the power at this point in time with the current and the voltage coming through the zero line would have been very low. So it had to go through the zero line and then build up again for that energy to build up to energize that solenoid. So hence, because we're coming through a bottom part coming through the negative, less energy then building up, the trip period would have been longer. That's what I'm surmising. It does make sense. And we'll see what the further test results yield. And just to end things off, what I'm going to do now is change the parameters of the testing. I'm going to dial the variac up, which is going to increase the voltage and the current at the same time because we've got no resistive load. So that's going to increase the power and ultimately the energy going through the trip switch. So at the moment, we're sitting at about 59, 60 volts, 1.35 amp. And that's about 81, 82 watts. So as you can see, if you look at the scope, as I dial things up, you'll see the waveforms change. You can see the lights getting bright on the side. I'm now at 240 watts, roughly. So about 122 volts, 1.9 amp. And we'll start our testing at that. Right, we'll set up for the first test with those parameters. 1, 2, 3. There we go. Let's have a look at that. Here we go with added energy. That was a cycle. This is the point where the trip activated, where I switched things on. You can see the current coming in and it was moving towards the negative. So we didn't have much power at that point. Our power was very low, our power and energy. And then we're moving into the negative cycle. And that's when we had a lot more power, which would have activated the solenoid. and that's when we can see things cut off. So I've got the X1 and X2 measuring that pulse width, and then we've got the various measurements down here, which I'll note now. I'll just quickly pull you into this last capture. I've got the waveform in display, and I've got the period, and I've got the measurements. The one thing I will just point out, there's an interesting trend from the previous set of measurements and now in terms of the amps peak to peak versus RMS. We'll see now there's more consistency on the RMS reading versus the peak to peak reading. And this is showing out here as well. If you can see between our last two tests, the peak to peak was 20 and 12, where we had consistently around 5.5, 5.4. So here the RMS value of the current seems to be far more consistent on the AC side. We'll have a look at the, we'll review the energy as well. And then the pulse, you can see here, the cycle had just come through the negative and was moving up to the positive and then going back down. And that pulse, if we have a look at the cursor, was 6.6, 6.7, which is kind of in the shorter duration. It would be interesting if I could catch it right as it was at this peak to see how short the duration would be as it was going through its peak power phase. We'll do a couple of more captures and then analyze the results. I don't believe it. That was total luck. It looks like I've caught it just at almost at the peak as it's going into the positive cycle. So let's just take a closer look at this one. Okay, so I couldn't have asked for better timing, and of course it was totally fluke. There's a good chance that I wasn't going to get this result, but as things tripped, it was basically almost at the peak of the positive cycle. So the peak of the positive power, which meant there had been the maximum amount of power and energy flowing into the solenoid. So that meant, if you have a look at the position of the X cursors, that period, I've noted all the values down here, which we'll have a look at the end. But if we have a look at the cursor, that period for the current was 3.5 milliseconds. So that's the shortest we had. And as I surmised, which seems to be the case, is obviously if you catch it at the peak of the cycle, you're going to have the maximum power. So that means you're going to have the shortest duration for the trip to occur. Whereas if you catch it when you, let's say you're coming out of a peak, whether it's a positive or the negative, but going towards the zero line, then your period for the trip is going to be longer because you're at zero power or very low power and energy as you're crossing the zero line before you're building up again. So that was a nice result. And wow, for the last one again, it looks like I've just hit it again right at the peak, and we'll see what those measurements. In fact, I can see from the cursors that the time period of the current is even less. So on the last measurement, it looks like I did hit it smack on the peak. I've noted all the measurements here. And if we go to, we can see the period of the current pulse. If I go to the cursors, 2.9 milliseconds. And that's the lowest one that we've had today because I hit it just at the right time. So just to wrap things up, looking at the measurements, it's always perhaps dangerous for me to kind of make any real finite conclusions from the results. But on the DC side, we'll see that because you're working with DC, both the peak and RMS values are very similar because you're not dealing with an AC waveform. And they tie up closely through most of the testing. Once, however, we get to the AC side, and I say here was a surprise to me. I was honestly expecting the energy to be a key indicator or a constant across all of these. And the energy is not quite constant. It's fairly similar, but well, I say fairly similar. You can see where I hit it at the peak, there was less energy involved in those cases. But if we have a look at the peak to peak, if you're trying to get a good specification for the instantaneous trip on the trip switch, then the peak to peak values vary quite dramatically. Whereas if we look at the RMS values, they stay reasonably constant across both of the test results. So from the measurements I've taken anyway, it would seem to make sense to, if you're going to do any if you're going to have any specification or tool doing a measurement for your instantaneous trip on a breaker, it would seem to make sense to use the RMS value. That is the value which is used on the, for the most part, on the spec sheets of breakers, but as I said, different tool sets vary. The HD Instruments tends to uses the RMS value, as I've demonstrated previously, whereas a lot of this Fluke instrumentation uses the peak-to-peak value. Hopefully you'll have a little better understanding on the mechanisms inside a breaker or a trip switch which cater for overload or instantaneous shorts. The measurements that I've taken, hopefully they're of interest. They might provide some guideline in terms of what the better measurement is to judge the, let's say, the instantaneous braking of one of these breakers. Certainly, if you want to add your comments below, if you've got better expertise or input, then do that below. But anyway, thanks very much for watching, and I'll catch you soon for the next video. Cheers.